As a kid, anytime someone would ask me what I want to be when I grow up, I would always respond with the same thing. A biologist and the president of the United States. To be honest, this was mostly because I share a birthday with Charles Darwin and Abraham Lincoln. But in my six-year-old mind, that was a perfectly logical way to pick a career. And somehow it came true. I am a biologist, still working on that second one. But as a scientist, I get to study some of the smallest, simplest units of life and ask the most complicated questions. And it's this methodical system of asking questions and testing answers that really attracted me to basic research in the first place and has led me to become a stem cell biologist. And now, around the time that my childhood self had settled on a career, was the first time that stem cells were being grown in a lab, nearly 20 years ago. And this was met by a strong response from the media and the public in general. Dr. James Thompson of the University of Wisconsin-Madison had figured out how to grow human embryonic stem cells in the lab. And there were two opposing reactions to this news. On the one hand, medical professionals and patients suffering from degenerative diseases were excited at the prospect of what this meant for them. But on the other hand, a debate ensued. Just a couple of years before this, there had been a ban on federal funds for any research in which embryos were destroyed. But private companies could still pursue this work. So Geron, a biotechnology company founded in 1990, funded Dr. Thompson in his work to produce embryonic stem cells from the excess embryos that come about during in vitro fertilization. And now these excess embryos are normally frozen and stored at fertility clinics. And so for a long time, the debate circled around this issue. The two questions that were always asked were, one, should we consider these frozen embryos a life? And two, if they're going to be discarded eventually anyway, wouldn't it be better to use them for medical research? Studying the simple units of life had led not only to exciting scientific questions, but also a challenging ethical one. But what if we didn't need embryos to study stem cells? What if there's a scientific solution to this ethical problem? We'd be able to move forward with work that could help us treat degenerative disease without the ethical concerns. And about 10 years ago, that was no longer a what-if question. On the same day in 2006, Dr. James Thompson and Dr. Shinya Yamanaka published work in two of the highest impact scientific journals, announcing they could make stem cells from skin. This work has been so impactful that Dr. Yamanaka, who did this originally with mouse skin as a proof of concept, was awarded the Nobel Prize in Medicine in 2012. And now the field of stem cells had two major tasks ahead of it. In terms of the science, they needed to show that these skin-derived stem cells were just as potent as the embryonic ones. And in terms of the ethics, we are still working on shaking off this controversial reputation that's developed, which is no easy task after two decades of scrutiny and misinformation. This technological advancement in stem cell research is allowing scientists to study and potentially treat degenerative disease all without the use of embryos. And when Thompson and Yamanaka set out to figure out how to make stem cells from skin, they had to turn to their embryonic research and ask the question, what even makes something a stem cell? And there's really just two things that make a stem cell special. The first is that it has to be able to reproduce itself indefinitely by dividing over and over again. Our normal cells can't do this. They can only multiply a certain number of times, which is why we can't live forever. The second characteristic is that stem cells are actually unspecialized. They're kind of like a college freshman that hasn't picked a major yet. But with the proper guidance and cues from its surroundings, that stem cell can become any type of tissue in the body. And we have ways in the lab to take those stem cells and make beating heart cells, active pancreas cells, or even beating active neurons and beating heart cells, whichever I didn't just name. All of them. And it's clear why an embryonic cell would need to be able to divide over and over again and produce all of the parts of an organism. But it is not so clear how you can take an ordinary skin cell and make it act like an embryonic cell. And to understand this, it's helpful to think about what these two things have in common. And that is, the skin cell and the stem cell both contain a full copy of our DNA at the center of the cell. And our DNA acts as this giant instruction booklet that our cells can go read and transcribe portions of to figure out what they're supposed to be doing. The trick is, cells only read the parts that are relevant to their function. So a muscle cell in your heart is going to transcribe what it needs to know to contract, whereas a cell in your pancreas is going to read what it needs to know to secrete insulin, and so on. What Thompson and Yamanaka figured out is that you can actually force a skin cell to transcribe the parts that a stem cell normally does. And they do this using just four proteins, which are appropriately called transcription factors. And what these do is get into the skin cell and tell it to turn on genes and produce proteins that will allow it to divide over and over again and produce any type of tissue in the body. And this process is now called reprogramming. And we have defined procedures in the lab to take these reprogrammed cells and make whatever cell type we'd like. And what my advisor, Dr. Dennis Clegg at UCSB, was interested in is how we could use these reprogrammed cells to study blindness. And Dr. Clegg's been studying blinding diseases for many years. He started with a disease called age-related macular degeneration. This disease is the leading cause of blindness amongst the elderly in the developed world. And at the time Dr. Clegg started this project, scientists were using embryonic cells. So he and his team, with a grant from the California Institute for Regenerative Medicine, figured out how to turn those embryonic cells into the type of cell in your eye that's destroyed by this disease. And from that work, he and a team at the California Project to Cure Blindness are currently in a phase one clinical trial where they're actually transplanting those cells into the eyes of patients with macular degeneration. And unlike most stem cell clinical trials, which rely on embryonic sources, there are in fact trials in Japan that are using these skin-derived reprogrammed cells in patients with macular degeneration. And unlike the embryonic sources, these cells are from the patient themselves, which reduces the risk of an immune response. Just like an organ transplant, these cells are introducing foreign material into the body. And what the reprogrammed cells do is reduce the risk of an immune rejection and also expand how we think about personalized, or precision medicine. It's due to the advanced surgical techniques that exist in the eye, as well as good endpoint parameters for measuring rescue of vision, that cell therapies in the eye are really leading the rest of the field. Unlike macular degeneration, there are other blinding diseases that start when a patient is young, like retinitis pigmentosa. This is the most common form of inherited blindness. It affects about 1 in 3,000 people. These patients have vision when they're children, but it starts with a loss of night vision, followed by a gradual loss of peripheral vision, and eventually can lead to total blindness. On a personal level, these patients have to cope with the fact that their sight will slowly evade them. They will likely need to learn Braille, train a seeing eye dog, or walk with a cane, and lose some of their independence. Currently, this diagnosis is a grim one, with little that the doctor can do, leaving the patient with little hope. But where we can look for hope is with reprogrammed cells. This disease is caused by a mutation, or simply a typo in the patient's DNA that's causing the cells in their eyes to degenerate. In fact, there are many different mutations across dozens of different genes, and any one of those can be enough to cause retinitis pigmentosa. But until recently, we really were not sure how some of these typos were causing degeneration of the eye specifically, and that's largely what my project is focused on. During my second year of graduate school, when I joined Dr. Clegg's lab, they were focused on macular degeneration. So I can clearly remember the day I came into lab to find a paper on my desk about an entirely different disease, retinitis pigmentosa, complete with a little note in the corner that said, "See me!" exclamation point, signed Dr. Clegg. So I walked across the hall to his office, which on UCSB's campus is complete with a panoramic ocean view, bookcases, floor to ceiling, filing cabinets stuffed with decades of Xerox research papers, taxidermy animals everywhere you look, including a human brain preserved in a pretzel jar. But upon entering, what I can remember most is how excited Dr. Clegg was about this brand new type of project he had for me. Clegg has worked closely with Dr. Thompson over the years, and Thompson's lab had produced reprogrammed cells from a patient with retinitis pigmentosa. And this is where the potential of these cells really comes into view. Imagine you're that patient, maybe about 14 years old, given the diagnosis of a degenerative disease with no treatment plan. But your doctor tells you, if you're willing to give a skin sample, scientists can make stem cells and functioning eye cells to learn about and study your disease in the lab. So shortly after my meeting in the taxidermy office, Thompson's lab sent us a frozen package full of vials of cells, and each one of these little vials contains millions of reprogrammed stem cells. And there were some that had this mutation, but then there were others for which the mutation had been corrected using a brand new gene editing technology at the time called CRISPR. And so for the past couple of years, Dr. Clegg and I have been working on a disease model where we take these mutated and corrected stem cells, make fully functioning eye cells, and then try to find the differences between the two. Not only can we make one cell type at a time, but we can actually produce entire small eyes in the lab. Shown here is a cross-section complete with the DNA in blue, light-sensing cells in red, and a protein we know causes the disease in green. We're doing this not just for the cells that I received, but also for other mutations that can cause retinitis pigmentosa and other blinding diseases entirely. These two incredible technological advancements, skin-derived reprogrammed stem cells and gene editing using CRISPR, are allowing us and other scientists to answer molecular and cellular questions about this disease that the field has been struggling to resolve. Let's be clear. It will be a lot of work before these technologies are widely used in patients. My dream is for the future treatment of degenerative disease to be a simple and straightforward process. You could imagine a doctor takes a skin sample or maybe something less invasive like a cheek swab from a patient, sends those off to a scientist who can make as many stem cells as you'd like, correct any mutations, and then bring the cells that the patient needs. But in order for this treatment to be a reality, we need to make sure we can make all of these different cell types efficiently, that we can precisely edit the mutations, and that we can safely transplant the cells back into the patients. And while this is in the somewhat distant future, this technology gives me hope. And more importantly, it gives the patients hope that future generations won't have to suffer from the same diseases that they currently face. And there's value in hope. There's value in going to a doctor's office and being given options rather than a grim diagnosis. With the invention of reprogrammed cells, we're learning that the ethical considerations of stem cell research should no longer be a concern. I invite you to embrace this technology fully so we can further our potential to improve lives and treat disease. Thank you.